What's up guys, my name is Saurav and this is my YouTube channel Data Science Novice. So if you are new to my YouTube channel, please do like and subscribe. Your efforts are massively appreciated. So this is the second part of the project, and in the first part we saw how we can segregate the variable based on the data types, and then we filled the missing values for the categorical column. So if you haven't watched that video, go ahead and watch it, because this video is in continuation with the previous video. So far, we have filled the missing values for categorical column. Next step is to change the categorical columns into numerical one. Because machine does not understand the categorical column, or to be precise, they need numerical data. String data doesn't make sense to them. And for that, we are going to use target mean encoding technique. If you don't know about this technique, you can find it on my blog, and the link is in the description, so go ahead and check it. And now let's jump to the Jupyter notebook and write some code. So first I have to grab all the categorical columns, because we have only those categorical columns which have missing values. We can use the previous code, but I am going to write a different code so that you have better understanding of things and you have more option to choose from. So first we are going to create an empty list with the name catvar, and in that we are going to save all the categorical variable. Then we run a for loop on column. So for var in xtrain.columns, and this will give us the list of columns in the data set. Then we have to pass a condition. So if xtrain, then we pass the variable, and on that we call dtypes. So this code is saying grab the data type for that particular variable, and if it equals to 0, sorry, it has to be O, because O here refers to object. So if that condition is true, then we append that variable in the list. So this is another way to get all the categorical column. Obviously this code is much more convenient than the previous one. So let's do the sanity check and see whether we have intended results or not. And here you can see that we only have categorical columns, and you can use T for transposing the data. And now you can see that all the columns are categorical in nature. So for target mean encoding, we are going to write a function. So def, and the name of this function is going to be encoder, and it takes few parameters. So first it takes training data, then test data, then the third data we have for the Kaggle submission, and finally the target variable. So let me write this line of code, and then I will explain you what we are trying to do here. So let's choose one variable and apply all the code on that variable. So in this case, I'm going to go with lot size. So first, let's see what type of value this variable can take. So here we can see that it can take four values. Next, we are going to use the group by command. So this group by function groups the data according to the variable we have passed. And if we press shift enter, we get this kind of output. So to get meaningful result, we have to use some kind of aggregate functions like mean, count, etc, etc. So we call the sales price column on top of this, which is also our target variable. And then we can call the mean function. So this returns the mean house price for each category of this lot shape variable. So here the mean price of the house having IR1 lot shape is $2,1,999, and so on and so forth. Next, we sort this mean price so that we get result in ascending order. So by default, it returns in ascending order. You can use descending order as well. It won't matter much. So on an average, IR2 lot shape houses are expensive, and this is important from the analysis point of view. And if we call the index on this, we get these categorical variable in the order. Now we have the categorical values sorted according to the mean price. Once we have this categorical values in a list, next we are going to do is create a dictionary where we will assign this value as 0, 1, 2, 3, and so on and so forth. So this way we will be able to convert the categorical column into numerical ones. So let me do that. So first we have to save this code in a variable. Next we have, so this is a symbol for dictionary, and inside that I am going to run a for loop, and I am using enumerate function to loop over this variable. So here you can see that REG gets 0, IR1 gets 1, and so on and so forth. And this is according to the mean price of the house. So why did we do all this thing? This is because we want to create a monotonic relationship between the target variable and our feature, because machine learning algorithm performs very well when the relationship is monotonically increasing or decreasing. So now let me write the whole code, because most of the part I have explained and there is one thing to explain. So let me write that thing first and then I will explain you. Now we have to apply all these things on the data set. So what I'm going to do, so I'm going to use a map function that will map our dictionary. So wherever it will find that value, it will replace that value with the value contained in the dictionary. And this is something we have to do for all the data sets. So let's write for all the data set. Let me delete these cells first. So you can delete these cells by pressing D 2 times once the cell is blue. This is a shortcut to delete the cells. So now it is time to apply this function on the data set, and for that we are going to write a for loop, since we have to do it for each categorical column. And in that for loop we are going to call our encoder function, and in that we just have to pass our training data, test data, and the data we have to submit on Kaggle, and then we have to pass the target variable. And like that we just converted our categorical columns into numerical one. So let's do the sanity check. So I'm going to copy this code and paste it here. And let's run this cell. And now you can see that every categorical column is converted into numerical one. So you see, with the help of functions and for loops, we are able to do these things very easily. Had it been the case we had to do it individually, it will take a lot of time. So we have dealt with categorical columns, like we have treated the missing value, then we converted the categorical column into numerical one. Now we have to do the same thing with numerical columns. But in this case of numerical column, we only have to treat missing values. So I'm going to use the same code and make few changes. And if you don't know how this code is working, you can watch the previous video where I have explained the code. So first we change the name of the list. Next we have to change something in the if statement, and that is we have to call the function for numerical variable. And next we have to change the list name here. So that's all we have to do. Let's run this cell. Now let's do the sanity check. So let's print out all these variables. And here you can see that we have 3 variables that satisfy this condition. Now let's print out the percentage of missing value in these variables. So here we can see that the percentage of missing value, so lot front edge has 18% missing values, and so on and so forth. So there are many techniques that we can use for filling the missing values, but for this video I am going to use a simple technique, that is replacing the missing values with the mean, mode or median. And along with that we are going to create new binary variable that will flag these variables. And this is something we should always do with other variable as well. We should have done this with categorical variable, and I will encourage you to do the same. This way we are going to keep track that this value in a particular column was missing well, and we replaced it with some technique. And the more information can be found on my blog, why should we do that, you can find it there. So first we are going to run a for loop on num var na. Next we are going to create a variable that is going to store the mode for that particular column. So by declaring the variable inside the for loop, we are making this variable column specific. Hence the same variable can be used for holding different columns mode. And this is very efficient method, I would say. And next we have to create the binary variables that are going to work as a flag that will tell the algorithm that there were missing values and there were not missing values. Creating a new variable in data frame is very simple. We just have to pass the name inside the square bracket. So we call var, and then we add the string na. So this is going to create whatever the variable name and add the na string. Next we have to populate this data. So we are going to use numpy var function, and inside that we have to pass the condition that is going to be xtrain, and then the variable name is null, and if it's true give us 1, otherwise 0. Similarly we have to do this for all the data set we have, because if we don't do this we will have different dimension, and this will cause the problem during model building. So once we have created this binary flag variable, next we are just going to fill the missing values with the mode of the variable, and this is going to be very similar to what we have been doing so far, and we have to do this for all the data set as well. And let's do the sanity check. So I'm going to copy paste the same code, you can do that too. And here you can see that we have treated the missing values for these columns. Next, we are going to treat the outlier. So if you don't know about that, don't worry about it. You can read it on my blog post. Basically, these are the values that are way far off from the actual data. So we treat the outlier because it affects the algorithm, and we only treat outliers in the training data. And the reason can be found on my blog as well. So first we are going to create a list in which we are going to store all these continuous variable. As of now, I'm writing them manually, but your task is to find a function that can differentiate the data just like we did in previous two cases, like we created for the categorical variable, then we created for the numerical variable. Find out you can do it for the continuous variable as well or not. To find whether we have outlier or not, we use box plot that help us visualize the outlier. So I have written a function for that. So let me copy paste it here and then I will explain you. So this function takes two parameters. So first it takes the data frame, then it takes the variable for which we want to plot the outliers, right? So it plots two things. First it plots box plot and then it plots the histogram for that variable. So let's see how this is going to happen. Now we want to plot all these variables, and for that we are just going to write a for loop, and this will plot everything for us, and we don't have to do it for individual columns. So this will take some time to run, and now you can see that we have plot for all the variables, and this way we can easily plot for number of variables. We just have to add some variable in that list. Now how to read this box plot? This is something you should be aware of and you should read about it. Basically, whatever is outside the two horizontal line will be considered as an outlier. So in this case, we can see that these dots are outside the box plot. And on the right hand side, we have the histogram that looks skewed. And this is important because we fill outlier based on the data distribution. So don't worry about everything. You will find this on my blog and you can find theory and the formula for this as well. And if you scroll down, we can see that all the variables are in this list have this outliers. So we have to treat all of them. So the technique we are going to use is known as capping using statistical property. So in this case, we are going to use quartile to find out the upper and lower boundary. And if the value exceeds the lower or upper boundary, it will be replaced by either of them. So let's create a function for this. And we are going to name this function as quartile boundary. Next, it takes few parameters. So first we have to pass the data itself. Next, the variable name, which is going to be stored in var. And then we have to decide the upper and lower boundary, or you can say upper or lower quartile. So first we have to find out the upper quartile or lower quartile for the data. And for that, we are going to create variables. So lower quartile equals to df, then the variable. And to get the quartile, we just have to use dot quartile, and in that we have to pass the lower bound. On similar lines, we can create upper boundary. We just have to use the same code, and instead of passing lower bound, we have to pass upper bound this time. So this function returns two things. First, it returns lower limit and then upper limit for a particular variable. Now it is time to apply this function on the data and to treat the outliers. And for that, we are going to run a for loop on the list we created. Then we have to create two variables since our function is going to return two values. So to store them, we use two variables, and this is known as tuple unpacking. Then we call the function and pass the parameters we created. First, we have to pass the dataset itself. Next, we pass the variable name, and then we have to pass the values for lower and upper limit. So in this case, I'm going to go with 0.05 and 0.95, that is 5% and 95%. So once we have lower and upper values, our next task is to replace them. And for that, we are going to use where function that we used earlier. So np.where, and this function takes three parameters. So the first is condition itself. and the second parameter if the condition is true, and the third parameter is if condition is false. So here the condition is going to be variable is less than lower value that we calculated from the function. So if the condition is true, we replace it with the lower value, and if it's not true, we pass the where condition again and check for the upper value, and the logic is going to be same here. So you see, we have used nested where condition. So in a nutshell, it will compare the data point with lower value, and if it's not true, it will compare it with the upper value, and even if it's not true, it will return the actual value. So that means it's not an outlier. So you can see that we have put filters to screen the data to treat the outlier. So let's run this cell and let's do the sanity check by plotting the same graph. So let me copy paste this line of code here. And now here you can see that we do not see any dots. That means we have treated the outliers, and you can see that there is a slight change in data distribution as well. That is because we have played around with the data. That's why it is, you can see that we have spikes on either ends. That is because we have treated them with upper and lower values. So this way we can treat outliers. And this is not the only technique we have. I have talked about different techniques we can use to treat outliers. So don't forget to try all those techniques as well. So that's all for this video. And in the next video, we will do some more data cleaning and variable selection. So if you are new to the channel, don't forget to subscribe and press the bell icon for the future updates. Till then, bye, stay safe, and wear a mask.